Won't you please be seated? And if you can, as you have your Bible open, if you could turn with me to Matthew chapter 5, and we'll be traveling over to chapter 6 also here this morning. As we get into tonight's study, we'll be in Isaiah chapter 13. Important portions of scriptures, as all of it is, but it really deals a lot with the last days, the end times. If you have a chance, come on out, read ahead, or watch online as we'll be taking a look at Isaiah chapter 13 in particular, and then hopefully we'll be able to move on over to chapter 14 depending on time. But this morning, I would like to bring your attention to chapter 5, beginning in verse 43. Where Jesus here is again teaching to his disciples in the Sermon on the Mount, and he says, "And you have heard it was said, you should love your neighbors and hate your enemies." Of course, that's what they were taught probably from the kids growing up, that their enemies around, people who do wrong to them, it's okay to hate them because they deserve it, right? And that was just the way life was. You love those who love you, but hate those who aren't very nice to you. He says, but Jesus, of course, it corrects his saying, the tradition that they had been brought up under. He says, but I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you. And now he gets particularly in particulars with here. He says, those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. So he gives us three things to do. He calls them our enemies, and those who are enemies of the gospel, those who would come against you, he tells us and gives us a solution what we should do. He says, first of all, we should bless those who curse you. How are you supposed to bless them? Well, that's really up to you and what situation. You know, it's amazing when you come into a situation where people are angered or upset with you. And you then, in turn, give them a kind word or you give them something that is really opposite of being, you know, they're angered at you. You feel like, well, I'm justified. I could be angered back at them. But if you'd rather turn around and are kind to them, he says, this is what we should be doing as being his disciples. He says, bless those who curse you and do good to those who hate you. Now, doing good is action words. That you go above what you would normally do. You go the extra mile, that you're willing to help people, because the reason why people are where they are is because they don't know God as their Savior. They don't walk with the Lord. And so we have an opportunity to demonstrate God through our actions. So he tells them to do good to those who hate you and pray for those who spitefully use you. So Jesus here is exhorting us to action. To do something right is to pray for people. I think one of the greatest needs within the church is for us to pray. You know, we pray for each other, which is good. You pray for me, and I really appreciate that. But he's also talking about the praying for people in our neighborhood, people in our workplace, people who come against you, that you would put them on your prayer list and you pray for them. And my prayer is that they would come to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. That's the reason why they're acting out the way they're acting. And he says, pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. And notice how he says not only use you, but they're aggressive and they persecute you and they do things that are harmful to you. And he says that you may be sons of your fathers in heaven, for he makes the sun to rise upon the evil and the good and sends rain upon the just and the unjust. Jim and I, as we're driving into church here this morning, we're talking about how this beautiful sunny day that's out today, wasn't it gorgeous getting up? And he was telling me he got up like 3 o'clock in the morning this week, and he was out, you know, pushing us, you know, in his neighborhood. He was moving around in his wheelchair, praying for people, enjoying the Lord and all that. And he says how those birds were chirping. And that made me think, you know, those same birds chirp in my backyard too. And that's what Jesus is saying, that the sun comes upon the just and the unjust. God shows his love to everybody, for God so loved the world that we have an opportunity to pray for those people that God sets in our lives. He says, verse 46, for if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Don't even the tax collectors do the same? Otherwise, don't tax collectors have tax collector buddies? You know, they get along with each other. And it's kind of like when you have something in common. A banker will have banker friends. A butcher will have butcher friends, and so on. As you have find things in, that you're in common with, that where you could share your life experience with. He says, don't even the tax collectors do the same, where they get along with the people that they know and understand. But if you greet your brethren only, what do you have more than others? Otherwise, he says, are you really different than a non-believer? Because that's what they do. People get along with people of their like kind. You ever wonder why bars are so crowded on a Sunday night rather than filling up in church? Because they all get along. They're there for the same reason. And I think a lot of the reason is because they love misery and they all get together for a miserable time there in the bar. You know, but it's that he says that's what people do. They gather with other people that they like and they have like common ideas. He says, but we should go the extra mile. Even those who would come against us, that we should look to be able to minister to them and reach them. As he goes on, he says, therefore, you shall be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. And you go, oh, my goodness, what's he talking about? I'm not able to do this. I'm not able to love people who, despitefully use me or persecutes me or my family. You know, if they're not nice to me, I don't want to be nice to them. Yeah, you ever find yourself, somebody cuts me off, wants to beep their horn at me. What do I want to do back to them? Beep my horn at them, right? You know, that's our sinful, carnal nature. But he says, therefore, you shall be perfect. And that really brings me back, the whole story of the Sermon on the Mount is bring me back my need for Jesus, the need of the Holy Spirit within my life. As he opened up, he says, blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. And it's a progression, as I said, from the first verse of chapter 5 all the way through as we learn to seek the Lord, that the Lord gives us what? He gives us the Holy Spirit, enables us to do things that we can't do for ourselves, and he gives us very practical life situations where people are taking advantage of you, that you could pause and say, God, well, how would you have me act in this situation? Give me the words. You know, and the beautiful thing is that he's giving me the Holy Spirit to help me to really represent him in the world. And let's make sure we understand this as we look at this, that we're not condoning people's bad action. Sometimes we have this thought that Christians should be just a doormat for the world, that the world could trample over and walk over everybody because we're supposed to be a witness for Christ. But I don't believe that that's what it's saying here. What it's saying is our life should represent Jesus. Was Jesus a doormat for everybody? No, not at all. Especially when you saw the way he went into the temple and he saw the Pharisees and the Sadducees. He called them what? You Pharisees? He says, you hypocrites. And he had a few choice words for them, and he turned their tables upside down, and he had enough of them. But what he's saying is here is that, you know, that's the abnormal things. That's not the normal, that we should look to live and have our lives represent Jesus Christ in all that we do. And so that brings me to a place where I'm dependent upon the Holy Spirit each and every day. And what I've discovered in my life is I've been pondering these verses since the early 70s. I remember the first time I taught this, and I was asked over at Tustin High School to teach the campus life group, and this is the passages where I was at. And as a 18, 19-year-old kid teaching this passage, and I go, wow, how do we do this? How are we supposed to do this as individuals? We love Jesus, but, you know, like Paul says in Romans chapter 6, I have a problem. There's a problem inside of me that war. There's a war going on inside of me, my flesh versus the spirit. My flesh wants to retaliate. My flesh wants to do wrong. And that's where I think Paul nails it. He says the life in the spirit, but thank unto God that there's no condemnation for those who are led of the Spirit, who follow the Spirit. If we walk in the Spirit, he tells us that we should not, what, fulfill the lust of our flesh. We won't act out in a carnal, fleshly way. And I think it's so beautiful as I discovered in my life as I started growing as a young man and as I continue to grow even to this day, that if I choose to act upon God's word, if I take the first step to doing what is right when a situation comes up, then the Holy Spirit will enable me to take the second step. He will not contradict my will. He gives me the opportunity to choose to do right when conflicts comes up. Unfortunately, let me tell you something. Long as we're in this world, we will have conflicts. We'll have people that are just, you know, come against us, come against Christianity. You know, you go, especially today, the new trend is, really they like to get rid of all churches. They would like to, you know, stamp it out because we're so narrow in our thoughts. At least that's what they say. Well, I'm somewhat narrow because Jesus is that way. What did Jesus say about salvation? Did he say many ways can reach God? Many ways are right? Just figure it out for yourself? No, he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father but by me. And that's a choice. I've chosen to follow Jesus and the words of Jesus. So if you call me narrow, then I'm narrow. And I go out and communicate that to other people. And some people don't like me because of that. Even today, as we're broadcasting around the world on the internet, there's people that will, you know, if I go and post it out on Facebook, this message, they'll send me nasty text back like, take that thing down. You shouldn't put it up there. You're so narrow, whatever. Because they don't like Jesus. And this is what he's saying. He says, therefore, be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Otherwise, go out and be an example of Jesus. Do I make mistakes? As I said earlier, absolutely. But what you do with the mistakes is so important, especially within the text of within the body of Christ. And I love the way Paul writes in Colossians chapter 3, because Paul, I believe, not only was a very intelligent man, but he was a very down-to-earth man. He understood problems that would rise within people's life. And he says, if you have a quarrel, gets hitty. And I love it. He says, you think like, you know, I get this idea where my head's in the cloud, where everything's perfect. There's never a problem because we're all Christians. We're all going to love one another. And Paul says, if you have a quarrel, gets hitty, buddy. And I says, oh, he's writing this to the church, isn't he? Because little differences come up. And he says, he goes on, he says, even as Christ has forgiven you, so do you also. And so the standard by which we're to live our life, Paul says, is the way Jesus Christ has set the example for us. And that's why he's saying, be thou perfect, even as your heavenly Father is perfect in heaven. And let Jesus be that model that we should follow in all things. And he says, take heed to yourself in verse 1, that you do not your charitable deeds before men to be seen by men. Of course, that was very common during that time. If you were a Pharisee, a Sadducee, not only the way you dressed your clothes, you know, the way you walked into a building, you wanted to make sure everybody know how religious you were. And he says, your charitable deeds, and otherwise the things that you were supposedly doing for God, you wanted to make sure all men would see it. He says, otherwise you have no reward from your Father in heaven. Oh, my goodness. You looking for a pat on your back or you're looking for a blessing from God? I'm looking for a blessing from God. And he says, therefore, when you do a charitable deed, do not sound your trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the street, that they may have glory from men. Surely I say to you, they have their reward. But when you do a charitable deed, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, that your charitable deed may be in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will himself reward you openly. He says, it's almost like, you know, if you're going to do something kind to somebody, put your right hand behind your back. Because, you know, this, if you have them both out there, they're going to talk to each other. It's kind of comical the way Jesus put it, but it's really understandable. You should just be doing it in a way that it's under the Lord, where nobody even notices. But God knows, notices. You know, that's so important. And the things that you do for the Lord, that, you know, from your prayer ministry to how you're able to help people, to different things, as God stirs upon your heart, you think like, well, nobody notices it. Well, if nobody notices what you're doing, in a sense, it's a good thing, because God notices it. God sees what you're doing. He says, and he's going to reward you. Would you rather have a pat on your back that goes away right away? Or do you want to have that reward that doesn't go away, where moth or rust or nothing's going to be able to destroy it, but it's there in the presence of the Lord? He says, let your charitable deeds be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will himself reward you openly. Isn't it? I think it's a very important truth that Jesus gives us there, how he sees in secret. He sees us. He sees our motivation. He knows our thinking, which sometimes you go, oh my goodness. You know, but he sees us thoroughly and he loves us. Psalm 139, David says, it speaks about, you know, that how you knew me in my mother's womb. You knew me throughout. You know, such knowledge that you have of me is too overwhelming. Who am I that you still love me? And I sometimes think of myself like David. It says, who am I that you still love me, Lord? Because you know my thoughts and their origin. You know everything about me. And he sees our motivation, is what Jesus is saying here. And he'll reward you openly. He doesn't tell us how he's going to reward us. But you think about the blessings that God gives upon our lives, that he gives us. We just serve him, and then he turns around and blesses us. A friend of mine, we had a little business together. His name was Frank. And we enjoyed for a few years doing this little business together. And we always felt like if we would put God first in all that we do in the business, that if we would honor the Lord, that if we take care of his business, when we have an opportunity to use the business to minister to people, we would stop worrying about making a profit or making money, but rather we would minister to people. If we would take care of his business, God would take care of our business. Otherwise, God would pay our bills and provide for us and have more clients come in. And you know what? It worked. God continued to bless as we honor and put him first. And then he tells us how to pray. When you pray, you should not be like the hypocrites. So first of all, he dealt with our charitable deeds. Now he's talking like how we pray. You know, the hypocrites of the day or the hypocrites of yesteryear, the hypocrites of the day. He says, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the streets that they might be seen by men. And that's what you see as you move forward, how people like to really, they're looking to be, I don't quite understand it, but I see it, how people want to have their name in the lamplight, basically. And he says, surely I say to you that they have their reward. But you, when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut the door, pray to your Father who is in a secret place, and your Father who sees the secret will reward you once again openly. You see, the second time he's talking about as you're doing your charitable deeds, he's going to reward you openly. Now he says, if you do it under him in your prayer, in your prayer closet. And I think it's very specific where he says, when you go into and you shut the door, those quiet times before the Lord, you're there with God. And I think one of the greatest things that's lacking within the church is the lack of prayer. It's just spending time in praying. I've said it over the years, and I'll, you know, anytime I talk about prayer, I got to think about the man who influenced my life in prayer. His name was Pastor Ray Snook of Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa. He was a good old boy from Arkansas. If you ever knew Ray, he was a tremendous man of prayer. He always kept with him a list that he would write people's names down, and he would come in contact with him. And I asked him one day, Ray, what do you got there? What are you writing down when I'm talking to you? Are you writing down secret information about me? He said, no, that's my prayer list. because so I can remember. I have trouble with my memory. They go back and to pray for people, you know, and I think it's so beautiful that if we, he says, if as you spend times in prayer, you're communing with the Father. Hey, the greatest gift that you can give somebody, I believe, is interceding for their lives through prayer. The most powerful things that you can offer somebody is prayer. That's what I covet from you. The greatest gift that you can give me is that you stand in the gap and you pray for me. And as we pray one for another, and he says, as you pray to your Father who is in the secret place, he says, God will meet you there. Do you see that? You go to your quiet place, and the Father will meet you in that secret place. And that's kind of, as you think about who he's speaking about, God the Father who created heaven and earth, he will meet you at a time where you can have communion. And, of course, prayer was very interesting back then, even to this day. You ever were brought up in a church or around a place that you felt like you had to go through somebody in order to pray? You had to go meet with a priest. You had to go through a certain type of pastor, or, you know. But we found out one of the greatest things that I learned out of the book of Hebrews. It says that me as a believer, you as believers, you can come boldly before the throne of grace at any time to find mercy and help at the time of need. That door has been swung open because of Jesus Christ. And it tells us that Jesus ever liveth to make intercession for us. He's there before the Father praying. And he goes, and when you pray in verse 7, do not use vain repetition as the heathen do, for they think they will be heard for their many words, their many, many words. Therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things that you have need of before you ask him. And in this manner, therefore, pray. He says, God knows you thoroughly. You don't have to keep begging over and over. You just got to come to him by faith. Somebody asked me, well, is it okay if I pray 2-3 times about a situation? And I always say, you bet. Every time it comes in your mind and every time it comes into your heart, I think it's okay to bring it to the Heavenly Father and continue to pray, be persistent in prayer. But this, he's talking about the vain repetition. We're chanting of words that, you know, that we have a tendency to, we figure that, I don't know what it is, what they do, where they feel like they chant Mary's name and they chant different names. It's going to make them right before the Lord. He says, no, he says, your Heavenly Father even knows what you're thinking about beforehand. Just come to him with your needs. And then he gives us this model. And I love that in this manner, therefore, pray, our Father in heaven. And he gets us right where we need to be. Our mind off the situation and the problems of the world and having our minds think about where we're speaking to our Father and that he's in heaven. He's above our problems. Don't you like that? He understands everything that's going on. And hallowed be thy name, a name that, you know, it's hard to even pronounce his name, how holy it is, how beautiful it is. He says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I think it's very interesting where Jesus is talking about the kingdom that's yet to come. Like I said, tonight we're going to be talking about the kingdom of God and the fact that it is coming real soon. And there was a move afoot that's one day that we could move here in the United States. We could change this world where this world would become Christianity and we could have the kingdom of God right here. No, well, Jesus says the kingdom of God is coming. It's a different kingdom. He says, your kingdom come, your will be done. Seeking to have the will of God here upon this earth. When you pray, are you praying for your will to be done or are you asking for God's will to be done? Sometimes it's different, isn't it? Lord, I would like you to buy me a Mercedes-Benz. But if it's your will for me to end up with an old Volkswagen van, I'll take it. I ended up with the old Volkswagen van, 63 Volkswagen van, and I loved it. Because God knows what we need. And if we pray for his will to be done on earth as it is in heaven, that my life would reflect that which is being done in heaven. And that's a good thing because heaven is filled with glory and grace. It's filled with joy. It's filled with peace and everything that's right. I want it to be done. And then he gets down to the practical things. Give us this day our daily bread. Isn't it interesting that the Lord knows our needs? He knows that we have daily needs. Whatever it is, it's okay to bring them to the Lord. I think it's really, you know, normally verse 11 is my first verse, of rather than, oh, Father, who, which art in heaven, I write and say, Lord, I got a problem. When you read Psalm 119, it's filled with all kinds of prayers. In Psalm 119, I believe the author of that was David himself, but, you know, we don't really know. But a lot of the times is the prayers, Lord, help me, I'm in a jam. I'm stuck in the pit again. Get me out, please. I think that's a very acceptable prayer. Give us this day our daily bread. And then forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Let's get personal now. Forgive us our debts. Our debts that we owe God. The debts that we are overwhelmed. Lord, please forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Otherwise, when we're seeking forgiveness in our own lives, and then we will be like our Heavenly Father, willing to forgive one another. And he says, and do not lead us in temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. That evil one is personal there. It's Satan himself and the trickeries of the devil. And he says, please keep us from the temptation, and the enemy would want to trip me up there, even this day, Lord. The enemy would want to bring in doubt and fear within our lives. He says, do not lead us to temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. He says, for yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The kingdom of God belongs to him. The power, all power belongs to him. The glory belongs unto him. And it's a beautiful thing when we pray that, as we, you know, use this as a model within our lives, it helps us to remind us who God is. That he has all power, this kingdom, eventually this world, everything that exists belongs to him, and that we give him glory. As we finish up here today in verse 14, where if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses. Ooh, that's a kind of a big one, right? He ties it together, everything about prayer, everything that we need, that we would then act the way God acts. God is willing to forgive us of all of our sins, and then us being his disciples, we should reflect that by forgiving one another. And I love it that he's speaking to his disciples, because, you know, they were kind of rowdy guys. They had strong personalities, Peter and John, and, you know, even later on, Paul had some conflicts with Peter and Barnabas. And, you know, there wasn't like a perfect world where they all sang Kumbaya and went down the merry road. But there was conflict at that time. But he says, if you're willing to forgive, you'll be able to experience the forgiveness of God. But if you don't forgive, if you harbor bitterness, he says, oh, my goodness, you'll miss out. Such a simple teaching. And when you look at it, you go, oh, my goodness, Lord. Maybe there's things I've been harboring in my own heart. Maybe there's things that I need to confess and ask for forgiveness of your Father, because I don't want anything to get in my way with my relationship with Jesus. And he tells us if we just simply forgive, isn't that something? But you know what it does? It constitutes our will. Our will that moves into action. And our action will then be demonstrated through our words and the things that we do, that we're willing to represent Christ to this dying world. Why don't we go to the Lord in prayer? Father, we do thank you this day. Thank you as we look here into Matthew and your teaching, as you, Lord, we're speaking to the disciples. As you opened up, just teaching us, Lord, how important it is to experience your love. And just not to love the lovables, but to love the unlovables. And Lord, that really demonstrates to me is the the life of the Spirit, the walk of your Spirit each and every day, that I might represent you well to this world around us, that all of us, Lord, and I just pray that your Holy Spirit would come upon us. Lord, that we would then take the words that you gave us here this morning outside these walls and let people know of the love of Jesus, because the world needs you. They're hurting even this day. So we ask for this miracle that you might do, yes, in Jesus' name. Amen.